love? Are you scared?
I don't know. I think I probably am.
I'm terrified. Who cares?
Is Sarah losing her religion or just her mind? Don't miss The Early Start, tomorrow at 7, BBC One. It's full of East End promise.
Hamish is getting away from it all, except women.
Do you have someone in Loch Doo?
His wee dog. And work.
She was found dead at the foot of the East Cliffs.
They're talking about a murderer.
Do you think he did?
Constable Macbeth, very interested in past events.
The law? On this island?
Laura's a bitter young woman.
A policeman's holiday.
Why are you bothering with all this stuff, Mr. Macbeth?
Hamish Macbeth, Sunday at 8 on BBC One.
A report on cryogenics, and for St Patrick's Day, the growing obsession with Irish pubs here and now, tonight at 7.30 on BBC One. The midday news now on BBC One with Moira Stewart.
Good afternoon. The Prime Minister has gone to Buckingham Palace to ask the Queen to dissolve Parliament. When Mr. Major gets back to Downing Street within the next hour, he's expected to confirm the general election will be held on May the 1st.
So finally, the moment arrived and the Prime Minister swept off to Buckingham Palace to discuss with the Queen the formal dissolution of Parliament and the election date of May the 1st. They were all smiles after a cursory cabinet meeting, despite having been given the news that could end their ministerial careers within weeks. The Labour leader welcomed the news that after months of speculation, the waiting was almost over.
At long last, we're delighted the campaign's underway. I mean, of course, an informal campaign's been going on, frankly, for the last year, more or less, and there's been very little governing happening of the country, and I think the choice will be between a Conservative Party that most people feel has run out of ideas and is out of date, and a new and revitalised Labour Party.
The Deputy Prime Minister will be a chief lieutenant in John Major's election team. Today he was already practising his lines.
Conservatives got to win because we deserve to win. We have the best economy in Europe because the Conservative policies made that possible. A lot of hard-working people have responded to that, and that's why the country's doing so well.
The Prime Minister is expected to return from Buckingham Palace shortly to make his formal announcement in Downing Street.
Our political correspondent, Nick Robinson, is in Downing Street. So, Nick, this is the start of the election campaign proper.
That's right, the start of one of the longest election campaigns in political history. The Prime Minister will return here soon to talk to the massed ranks of cameramen, reporters, microphones to confirm that that election is going to get away. And straight away he's going to head out of London and we're told meet the people. Go to a constituency outside London, to a marketplace, and there's even rumours that that soapbox, which has such spiritual importance for John Major in elections, is going to come out once again as he talks to the voters. Tony Blair will wait till this evening when he faces voters for questions and answers in Gloucester, but we're really underway soon.
What about those proposed television debates? Any progress?
Well, what we've heard this morning is Tony Blair confirmed that, like John Major, he would rather that these debates are head-to-head, just between himself and the Prime Minister. Although he said there may be a role for Paddy Ashdown, he thinks the broadcasters should sort it. Like any negotiation, of course, we don't know what the bottom line is in this situation. Will the Prime Minister refuse to do anything with Paddy Ashdown in terms of debates? Will Paddy Ashdown insist that he has exactly equal status with the other parties? Until those bottom lines are revealed, we simply won't know what can happen and when.
Nick, for the moment, thank you. The Court of Appeal has quashed the conviction of a former aide of the fugitive businessman Asil Nadir. Elizabeth Forsyth had been convicted of handling £400,000 of stolen funds. Four people have been killed in an explosion in a bar in Brussels. Police say petrol bombs were thrown into the bar. Several people have been arrested. The next news is at 1 o'clock, and before that, BBC One will go live to Downing Street for the Prime Minister's formal announcement of the general election date.
But first, the headlines in the South East. Good afternoon. Violent crime increased in London and the South East by almost 19% last year, nearly double the national average. But according to new figures from the Home Office, the overall number of offences fell in some parts of the region, including Kent and the Thames Valley. Essex firefighters begin voting today on whether to hold a series of strikes. They say the service will be affected by plans to cut £1.5 million from the county's budget. Councillors say firefighters' jobs are safe, but union leaders leaders claim a recruitment freeze will leave 50 posts unfilled by next year. A critically ill man who was wrongly discharged from intensive care is considering suing the health authority. Donald Blevin, a diabetic, says he nearly died in Kingston Hospital last May. An independent report has strongly criticised the care he received. Businesses in London have launched a campaign to win more money for the Underground. The consortium London First says cuts in government subsidy herald the decline of the tube network. They're calling on all the political parties to commit themselves to an increase in funding. Well, those are the headlines. I'll be back with a full summary of regional news after the 1 o'clock news here on BBC One. But now look at the national weather prospects. At the map, Helen Young.
Hello. Well, the spring bulbs have been blooming in the last couple of weeks due to the warm weather in Britain. It's not just Britain that's seeing that warm weather, though. So too France, Spain and Portugal, where there's a good deal of sunshine. Further afield, though, in central parts, you can see this band of cloud. That's been giving some heavy bursts of rain, particularly through Austria so far this morning. And then in the northeast, this cloud is actually producing snow. More snow to come for the rest of Monday, then. Still rather chilly here. But heading further southwest, we pick up that warm weather. Temperatures in Portugal and Spain around the 20 degree mark. Now in Britain we're not far away from that either, but during the next couple of days it's going to be turning colder. First of all, in the north of Europe, those blue colours pushing their way down into central parts as we go through to Wednesday. That cold weather's going to arrive in Britain, but probably overnight. Thursday night, certainly a harsh frost for many, and so too on Friday night. So quite a change in the weather there. Gardeners beware. Well, certainly for this afternoon, it's going to be a warm one yet again in southernmost areas. Temperatures around 15 to 16 degrees. That's into the 60s Fahrenheit. Further north, rather warm as well, 10 to 13. For this afternoon, the best of the sunshine will be in central, southern and eastern areas of England. Cloud and drizzle, though, back out towards the west with more persistent rain in the far northeast. Overnight tonight, that cloud and drizzly rain spreads its way southeast, with many places probably staying dry, with clearer conditions coming into Northern Ireland and also Western Scotland. Temperatures tonight around 6 to 7. Bye-bye.
When freedom is close at hand...
We're all right with that one. His old ma's going to keep him in check.
You'll see when you come home next weekend.
Home for your birthday.
Reality sets in.
He'll be out in a few weeks. He needs training, not sitting around all cosy.
But there are some things you can't prepare for.
She was okay yesterday. She's never ill.
Stories from an open prison.
What am I going to do now, Mr. Pine?
Insiders, Wednesday, 9:30 on BBC One.
A change to our schedule now on BBC One. Instead of the alphabet game, a special programme from Westminster with Nick Ross.
It's all been so inevitable, and yet now the moment is here, curiously dramatic. Good afternoon. This is the announcement we all knew must come about, a date that was generally anticipated, and an event that's still more than a month and a half away. But let no one underestimate the surge of adrenaline in Westminster today among politicians and the press corps. It remains to be seen how much excitement a 6.5-week campaign can generate and sustain among the general public. It's certainly the longest election campaign since the 1950s, and a crush of journalists and camera crews has been gathering in Downing Street since a procession of cars brought ministers to the cabinet meeting at 10:30. At 11:25, the Prime Minister's car swept him off for the 5-minute drive to the palace, with a police car impossibly close on guard behind and a police helicopter clattering in the sunshine overhead. The palace itself, surrounded, as you can see, by onlookers. I suspect most of them were tourists there to see the horse guards, who were rather bemused by the arrival of the PM's little convoy. Our political editor, Robin Oakley, is at Downing Street, waiting for the Prime Minister's return. When are you expecting him, Robin?
Well, possibly between 12:15 and 12:30, Nick. He's
as you said, gone off to the palace to inform the Queen officially of his request for a dissolution. We don't know quite how long she might detain him there. On these occasions have once or twice in the past lasted rather longer than anticipated by the Prime Minister. But we are expecting him back sometime between 12:15 and 12:30, and we hope that he will then come out and make the official announcement in front of the door of Downing Street. I gather his people are very keen for him to do it in this particular location rather than at a press conference in the Rose Garden or anything like that. They want to establish his firm tenancy of Downing Street, as it were, and to signal that he intends to stay on in these premises after the election.
And what's going to be the choreography of that announcement? Do you know, will Norma come out with him? Will Jonathan Haslam, his press secretary, emerge? What will happen?
I think it's most likely the Prime Minister will emerge just with his press secretary, Jonathan Haslam, hovering at a discreet distance behind him. Certainly the Tory plan in this election is to focus very much on Mr. Major. It is going to be very much a presidential contest. It is going to be very much focused on his personal qualities, in the same way that we saw him presented at the Tory Central Council meeting at Bath at the weekend, solo on the platform, not surrounded by a group of cabinet ministers.
When do you expect Parliament to be dissolved?
Well, last night the strong rumours were that Parliament might go on until Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday of next week, before the Easter recess. Now there's talk of Parliament actually winding up for the Easter recess at the end of this week, if they can have sufficient agreement with the opposition parties to get through what they regard as the essential bits of legislation. We would then have an Easter break, and Parliament would return after the Easter break only for prorogation, probably with just the possibility of a little business continuing then, but Parliament can actually be finally dissolved without being in session, without MPs having to return. So we don't know quite whether they will come back after Easter or not, but we'll certainly have to wait until after Easter for the party campaigns to take off in any big sense. We won't see the party manifestos produced until that week after Easter. I doubt if anybody will want to produce their manifesto on April the 1st, All Fool's Day, but quite soon after that we'll start seeing the manifestos, and the Tories' first big rally is at the Albert Hall on April the 4th.
Now, there was a brief cabinet meeting this morning, which John Major told them he was off to the palace. Kenneth Clark didn't arrive until a minute or two before it ended. Do you read anything into that?
No, it surprised us all. We haven't had an explanation yet of why Kenneth Clark was so late. Douglas Hogg, the Agriculture Minister, was missing altogether. He's on business in Brussels. Mr. Clark didn't seem particularly perturbed as he rolled up rather late. Possibly some kind of official business had detained him, but I'm afraid we don't have an explanation for that yet.
Robin, thank you very much indeed. We'll come back to you shortly, as soon as the Prime Minister returns to Downing Street. Meanwhile, here in our Westminster studio, right across the road from Parliament, we hope to be joined shortly by the Welsh Secretary, William Hay. We've already have the Labour Party Deputy Leader, John Prescott, and the man who's organising the Lib Dem campaign, Lord Richard Holme. John Prescott, could you still lose this?
Well, we're certainly not complacent. We read all that the polls are telling us. We see the Whittle by-election, that's comforting, but you cannot be complacent. We've got 6 weeks, if the date is to be the May the 1st, to get our case across, and you can be sure we're confident about doing that, but you have to earn the trust of the people, and that's what our case is.
There's been a phony war for a long time. Are
yes.
you all geared up, ready to go, or is there, frankly, a frantic pandemonium going on across
yes,
the way?
Yes, we're certainly geared up to go. I mean, we've been doing it for months, actually, and we just want it now. We have our programme set. We know we're already doing it today. We'll be on the road, putting the case across, and can be assured we're glad the phony war has ended, and we want to get across and putting Labour's positive case.
And what's going to be the target of your major guns? What's going to be the big issue?
Well, clearly we're going to be putting our case, and we've been doing that constantly. It seems to be working quite well in Whittle, as we saw even in the Tory stronghold. But the Prime Minister's distancing himself from his cabinet, isn't he? He obviously doesn't want to show a bitterly divided cabinet. So it's a kind of presidential style. So I'm sure competency is going to be one of the issues. The competency of this man, whether he can lead a cabinet or even lead his party. The competence of their record, which will certainly will be attacking. And I think that's going to be a key issue, since he's putting himself up as the only one that apparently can persuade people to vote Tories. They listen to their ministers, they watch their divided party, and so he has to put himself forward as the saviour.
If you're in opposition, it's the government that principally faces the risk of banana skins. In a 6.5-week campaign, that applies equally to you, of course.
Oh, yes.
Now, you've got to hold all your people together during
this. Of course, and I think we've done it very well. We've been in election mode basically for 12 months, quite frankly, and there's been no governing. The government's given up governing. They've been in this kind of electoral mode. So we have been doing that, but all elections face the possibilities under pressures you might get banana skins. But you can be assured that we'll be doing everything to make sure our case is a positive one, it's been thought through. We have the best leader, we have the best policies. I think we'll get the best result.
Richard Holm, you've got problems in facing this campaign, haven't you? You're 12% in the polls, only 6 weeks out. I mean, this is taking you right back to where you were in the 1960s, isn't it?
Well, you've been reading the wrong polls. The average share we have in the current batch of opinion polls is 14%, which is about what we had going into the last election. And I would say that it's a good springboard. The thing that's most strikingly different from last time for us is that we've targeted our resources, which are more limited than the other two parties, which have very generous financing from business and the unions. We have more limited finance. We've targeted our resources on the seats that we believe we can win. And we're looking forward to an extremely successful campaign on issues where I think it's fair to say that we are staking out a very different position from both the Conservative and Labour parties.
But this is the worst case for you, isn't it? A 6.5-week campaign for the party that has least funds, least resources.
Well, I take the view, despite what John said, that with this phony war that's gone on for a year now, that another week or two of it will do no harm at all. And we're not going to start our campaign properly until after Easter. We think people are fed up with this exchange of posters, with the slanging match that's been going on.
Sounds like you're not ready.
Well, no, we're perfectly ready, believe me. But we're not going to be firing an endless salvos at the electorate until after Easter. So we'll step up our activity, of course we will. But we think the electorate want a 4-week campaign, which is what they're used to, and we're not going to impose on them an endless campaign of slanging.
Well, if you look back to Downing Street now, you can see that the Prime Minister's Rover, I think that's the Prime Minister's Rover, has just arrived, or at least that may be one of the police vehicles. I think it was a police car. I'm not sure if the Prime Minister is yet there, but if he is, we'll go to Downing Street.
Through, I think, while you were talking, I think he went in.
Did you see him go in?
I thought so. Sure. Wasn't it the Prime Minister going in? I think so.
John,
he might have a shadow, who knows? He's got up to all sorts of tricks this election.
How much are you vesting? You say that a lot of this is going to be about competence. How much hope and importance are you vesting in this television debate?
I think the television debate is important, and indeed we were calling for it, and we're very pleased to see that the Prime Minister has now agreed it. The details have to be worked out, and I'm sure the Liberals will have a strong point of view about that. Those details can be worked out, as important as they are. But I think it is important also to have audience participation. I mean, it comes a bit of a rough and a tumble. I did one with Heseltine the other day. The real sharp questions really come from the audience. And I think it's important that in that debate, it isn't just a kind of presidential style, that you have the ordinary voters actually put in their questions.
John Major does very well in those circumstances.
Fine. Well, I mean, we like that to see it. We like to, we can be sure that we want that kind of debate. After all, we've been pressing him. The Tories have been, well, we might and we might not, and then putting it off, and now they've come round to it. I think they've been rather forced into the situation, but I don't mind. It is about comparing two leaders. I have no doubt who's the best out of those two.
Richard Holm, it is about comparing two leaders, isn't it? This is the classic problem the Lib Dems face so often. You appear to break out of it for a time, of being squeezed by the big two. There was that period when you really did surge ahead and out of that vice-like grip. But I come back to this question, and it's presumably one that will dominate the campaign as far as you're concerned, that you're now in the big squeeze again.
Well, I think in terms of the debate, which is the point you raised with John, we're not in a big squeeze. We just have some conditions laid down unilaterally by the Prime Minister, which is not the slightest reason that either the Labour Party or Liberal Democrats, or for that matter, the broadcasters should accept. After all, we want to remind ourselves, Nick, that the verdict here is the verdict of the voters. You can't second-guess them and say they've decided who's going to be Prime Minister. If I read the polls right, John Major's not going to be the Prime Minister. Are we saying he should be excluded from the debate? I certainly don't say that. So all the leaders of the three parties that are fighting a national campaign and have a proven record of national support, as a matter of basic British fair play, ought to be there. And so if there is a squeeze, and I don't accept there is, for goodness sake, let's have the media making it a squeeze. Let's try and treat people fairly. And I think on his merits as a leader, somebody with a lot of experience outside politics, Paddy Ashdown will stand out very well in such a debate and will compare favourably with the other two party leaders.
Well, William Hague, I hope, would be here. He's not yet, but Alan Duncan is, helping to run the Conservative campaign. This really is a tacit show of weakness, isn't it? That you're having to go for everything that someone in strength in number 10 would not go for. You're calling for a television confrontation now. You're calling for a 6.5-week campaign.
No, I think what it shows is that our challenge over the next 5.5 weeks is not so much to stop a bandwagon as, I would put it, to prick a bubble, and that bubble is Tony Blair. I think he's a fake. We've just heard from John Prescott, not a single positive policy about Labour. He's a great act, he's great fun, and we're all enjoying it, but actually we've got a serious choice to make on polling day, which we all think will be May the 1st, although we'll hear in a minute. So no, it's not a sign of weakness, it is an admission of the challenge we face, and we're going to face it, and we're going to face it hard, and we're going to put to the British people the clear choice that confronts them. And the choice is, we either keep going as we are, with the economic success we're having, or you're taking a very, very big risk with a man who's doing absolutely anything to get elected in the sort of way that people say, God, I wish politicians wouldn't do that. But that's just what Tony Blair and, I would say, John Prescott are doing. And in those 5.5 weeks, we are going to expose them. And if it takes a television debate to expose them, I relish the prospect.
Do you believe that over the next 6.5 weeks altogether, you're going to find that the rebelliousness in the Tory ranks is going to finish, is going to end? Will you now predict that's the last we're going to hear of headlines caused by people saying, oh, so-and-so should stand for the leadership after we lose, or we've got our policy wrong on Europe?
In all political combat, there are honest differences between parties and within parties. The real difference that matters now is the difference between the Conservative Party and the Labour Party. And you know, we all know, that Labour has been quite successful in the Stalinist management of its own party. Nonetheless, the package the British people would be buying if they were to vote Labour is a fraud. They've done everything they can to try and appeal to people, but behind it are very, very dangerous policies and a fraudulence which I think has to be pointed out, and pointed out vigorously. And I love elections, and I'm looking forward to the next 5.5 weeks to do
just
that. It's
going to be a very positive campaign with all that kind of rhetoric. I can remember you doing that in the Wirral. I can remember you doing it in Staffordshire.
I'd rather you didn't wag your finger
at me,
please.
Well, it doesn't really matter. You attack teachers and governors up in the Wirral. I wouldn't put him out wagging in the teeth. But that sounds very negative.
Can we just raise the tone a bit, please, Mr. Prescott? Come raise the tone a bit.
You've just dragged it down, son.
To St. Stephen's entrance of the House of Commons, just to see what some of the parliamentarians who are emerging or entering there are expecting from this announcement. Karen Quinn is there.
Well, yes, outside St. Stephen's entrance, obviously everyone waiting for that announcement, but I'm joined by Alan Howarth, the new Labour MP or candidate for Newport East, Matthew Taylor, Liberal Democrat, and Steve Norris. Now, Alan Howarth, first of all, you secured that candidacy last night. Obviously, this is going to be your first election fought as a Labour candidate. How are you feeling about that?
Well, I'm feeling thrilled, I'm feeling elated, and tremendously honoured that people in the Newport East Labour Party have put their trust in me, and I'm determined to fight as hard as I possibly can. There is a huge will for change. People have been waiting for this election to be called for a very long time. It seems that at long last, Mr. Major has actually managed to steel himself to call it. He's run out of time, and the Conservative government has run out of the people's patience and tolerance. We need change. We need to embark on the path of putting wrong to right in this country. There's tremendous injustice. There's been widening inequality, deepening poverty for the people who are left behind. And I think that the British people want a Labour government that will not only be hard-headed and realistic and competent in running the economy and taking the difficult decisions that you have to take in government, which always involves hard choices, but will all the time be committed to the values of social justice and compassion and the recognition that it's the proper responsibility of government to govern for everybody and not just let the devil take the hindmost, which is what we've had, I'm afraid, for far too long.
Well, Tony Blair's hailing you as an example of new Labour in action, but you're going to be fighting in an old Labour seat.
It's a very traditional Labour seat, and the values of new Labour are the enduring values of the Labour Party. We talk of new Labour because there has been a very searching rethink within the Labour Party. And certainly in terms of economic policy, we see the Labour Party going into an election campaign, it has to be said, with a different array of policies and a different array of assumptions about the economy from what you would have seen in the 1970s. And of course, we've had to move with the times.
Well, Steve Norris, obviously, now Alan Howarth, for him, it's all new, this type of campaign. But the phony campaign is already underway, isn't it? Do you think that we're going to get any clarity in the run-up to this election, or have we heard it all already?
I think we've had a fair rehearsal of a lot of the major argument, a lot of the main themes that are going to be enunciated. I don't think there's any doubt about that. I was just reflecting on how You know, for months we were told Mr. Major couldn't possibly name his own day, how he'd be derailed by this or that vote of no confidence, that somehow the parliamentary arithmetic would turn against him. He has, in fact, survived all that, as he always does. He's now called the election on his own terms, at least we assume that he's about to do it, on his own terms for his own date. I personally think he's made the wise decision to have a long campaign, because we need time, I think, to get away from what happens in the other 4 years and 10 months, which is when it's the job of the opposition to throw bricks and it's the job of the government to dodge them. What we're now going to be entering is that very interesting phase where actually it is going to be Labour and to some extent the Liberal Democrats who have to say how they are going to actually change Britain for the better. No more sound bites, thanks, because we've had a multitude of those. Let's have some actual sound policy input. I don't think there is that.
Well, Matthew Taylor, you want your leader to have more than a chance of just giving a soundbite during the debate, don't you? If John Major says, no, I'm only going to have a debate with Tony Blair, what do you do?
Well, I mean, the fact is that I'm sure we will get our place in those debates. Not only does the law require it, but much more important, fairness requires it as well. We'll be fighting nationally in every seat in this country. We'll also, of course, be fighting the local elections at the same time, where we run four times as many councils as the Conservative Party. So I think the broadcasters accept that. They've said so. And I think the Prime Minister will have to accept it. Perhaps, frankly, he doesn't want to debate with the party that's actually putting forward positive policies.
But don't you think that this message negates your campaign before it's even begun, because it's lessening the figure of Paddy Ashdown?
Well, I'm sure that's what the Prime Minister intends. I rather suspect that he both is worried about the impact the Liberal Democrats can have. We are, after all, in second place in half the Conservative seats. So we are as much of a challenger to the Conservatives as the Labour Party in those seats that matter to them. And equally, it's a simple fact that John Major wants to avoid the issues that we'll be putting forward. Investment in education, investment in the health service, and the problems that those services are currently suffering.
Well, I think we're going to be talking more about that off camera. Matthew Taylor, Steve Norris, Alan Howarth, thank you very much. And back to you, Nick, in the studio.
Thank you. Well, as you can see in Downing Street, a few officials coming out. There's just been some of the press staff from Number 10 testing that microphone, which is there up on the stand. And we're still awaiting the Prime Minister, who apparently is inside having a cup of tea, readying himself for this great announcement. Here is Peter Mandelson, whose political career, I suppose, has been building up to this point in the Labour Party, has it?
For 10 years or more, I think, I've been waiting for this moment. But there's still 6 weeks, very hard work to do. And as John Prescott has already said, we are not complacent. We're going to earn every single vote we get on polling day on May the 1st.
When you say you're not complacent, are you telling me the same question I put to John Prescott? Do you seriously think there's any prospect at all that you could lose this, that you could muff it?
There's always a possibility that we may not turn out as good and perfect a campaign as we would wish, and we're going to make sure that we, as a professional, modern, reborn Labour Party, are going to throw everything we have into this campaign, not simply because we want the jobs, not because we want to be the government after polling day, but because, unlike the Conservatives, we're not happy with the condition of Britain. We think Britain deserves better. We think it can do better. We think we can produce, create better schools from which everyone can benefit. A health service which is there when everyone needs it. More measures to get tough on crime and the causes of crime. Measures to tackle youth unemployment and the growing army of underclass, people who don't have a stake in our society. There's so much for us to do.
But these...
And we have the policies and we have the programme, and above all, Nick, we have the unity of our party and the leadership in our party to see it through.
Now these, and I don't blame you for that, because we've only got a few moments here to discuss these things, but these are generalisations. In 6.5 weeks of campaign, you're going to get tested on each of those policies to destruction, aren't
good.
You?
Good, good, good. And we will explain how we're going to achieve smaller class sizes in our primary schools and how we're going to pay for that by shifting resources away from the assisted places scheme, which benefits just a few of our
pupils. Well, the Tories at the moment
and I could do the same. I could explain for our health proposals,
sure,
for crime,
the
for the unemployed, and we're looking forward to doing so.
The Tories have these posters saying there's a bill of £30 billion that awaits you if Labour comes to power. When you publish your manifesto, will you provide some sums? Will you provide some statistics which show actually what your spending plans are?
We've made it absolutely clear that we are making no proposals in our manifesto in which we do not explain how they are going to be paid for. Every proposal, every measure is properly costed and properly funded. Let me give you an example of what I mean. We're going to create, as a Labour government, a programme to take 250,000 young under 25-year-olds off welfare and put them to work.
How?
We're going to pay for that by introducing a windfall levy on the excess profits of the privatised utilities. I think everyone in the country will think that is right and fair, because it's about creating one nation in our country again. That's what people want to see, and that's what I believe they're going to vote for on May the 1st.
If we can just cut back to Downing Street for a moment, you'll see a rather curious sight, which is a police officer holding up a piece of white paper. That's just so the cameras can get what's called a colour balance. I'm off, and you see that sight.
Prime Minister seems to have some difficulty learning his lines for this press conference. He's already rather late. It augurs rather badly for his campaign. Let's hope he comes out soon.
Alex Carlisle, who's going to be a senior figure in the Liberal Democrat campaign for this, are you all ready for the off?
We've been ready for months, because we had all anticipated the possibility of an October general election, and we've been simply perfecting our campaign since then.
Do you think the Prime Minister's rather boxed himself in for May the 1st? Would he have done better, do you think, going in October?
I think he may have tried to make a virtue out of necessity. It's not for me to advise the Conservative Party how to run elections, but I suspect they might have been rather better off in October.
But then, come May the 1st, the sun is shining, the economy is doing well, according to almost every economist and statistician. The cricket season will have started. I mean, everything... The trees will be in blossom, everything will be going
well. I've no doubt
well.
That we'll see John Major standing on a soapbox in blazer and flannels, purporting to be the best batsman in England. But I'm afraid that the arguments you were suggesting they'll put forward haven't cut much ice in recent months. The public are heartily fed up of this Conservative government and want to get rid of them. And I do believe that the way in which people vote will reflect a tactical desire to get rid of this Conservative administration.
Alan Duncan, I mentioned how well the economy seems to be doing at the moment, and I wonder if I wasn't John Prescott or Peter Mandelson, if I wouldn't be delighted at that, for two reasons. One, I would look as though I was about to inherit a thriving economy, which would make things a lot easier for me. But second, if you lot are going to go to such expense saying you're safer with us, the Conservatives, well, if I was reckoning on the electorate taking a gamble, they'd much rather gamble on a slight uncertainty of Labour if the economy is going well than if it's going badly.
Well, I don't think they will. First of all, let me just go to two specifics, because let's get into real debate here. The assisted places scheme, which Peter Mandelson's party proposed, forgot to realise that if you take people out of the assisted places scheme, you've then got to pay for them in the state scheme. So they're his flagship policy, the arithmetic collapsed straight away.
It's a lot
away.
Cheaper, isn't it?
Similarly, that's not the point, though. You only have a net saving, and he forgot to do the arithmetic. The second thing is a windfall tax. That's a one-off thing. He won't say which companies will be hit. He doesn't dare say. He just wants to try and cash in on discontent with utilities. But his employment programme would continue over a number of years. You cannot finance a flow with a stock. Economic ignorance. Let's go to your point about the economy. It's absolutely clear that Labour know that they would inherit an economy which is in the best shape since the war. And what they also know is that they could not fulfil their promises, and it is absolutely clear from Gordon Brown's comments that he would have a July budget, that they would, within months, welsh on all their promises and try and blame it on what they inherited, when we all know that what they would inherit would be in fantastic shape. People should not take a risk with us. You can only be sure with Conservative government, because we are delivering economic prosperity which Labour would threaten. And it's absolutely clear in the fact that their arithmetic would not add up. They know it, and they try and juxtapose economically illiterate things like, why do the Conservatives finance mass unemployment, when they know that actually you can't just get people back to work just like that and save money.
This is, I'm afraid, typical of the Conservative Party's tactics, which we're going to see in what could be the most vacuous election campaign of all time. How can people feel safe under the Conservatives when their children are in larger classes? How can they feel safe under the Conservatives when their community hospitals are under threat? How can they feel safe under the Conservatives when the roads are in worse condition than they ever have been before? You know, those are just examples of the effect of this Tory.
But you're the anti-roads party.
Come on. We believe, come on, let's not have that, Alan. You know perfectly well from the performance of Liberal Democrat Council
that
we believe in a transport policy which you're not even prepared to look at. And we've heard Steve Norris, a former roads minister, taking your government's transport policies apart.
So was David Rendell right to support the Newbury bypass?
Of course David Rendell was right to do what he thought was right in his own
constituency.
Before these two finish taking lumps out of each other, I think that what Alan Duncan has said this morning is very, very significant indeed. First of all, he's given us a taste of the election campaign. The very first thing he said when he opened his mouth at the beginning of this interview was to attack Tony Blair. I think we're going to see a very negative and a very personally abusive campaign from the Conservatives. You've seen it already.
You know all about that.
And one thing you won't be able to do is to shout down all your opponents. You'll have to engage in a debate. Second thing I'd say is this. What's absolutely clear is that coming from the Conservatives is a message that Britain's fine. Nothing needs to change. Our hospitals are fine. Our schools are fine. We don't have to care about the unemployed. We don't have to do anything more to tackle crime. It is a very complacent message indeed coming from Alan Duncan, whereas our view is that Britain can do better, it deserves better, but it can only get better from a new Labour government.
Let's go across to Downing Street. I think we missed the Prime Minister coming back from Buckingham Palace. Let's not miss his emergence to make this announcement. Robin Oakley is there. Robin, are you anticipating him any moment?
Yes, we are anticipating him any moment. His private secretary, Alex Allen, has just come out with Charles Lewington, the director of communications at Tory Central Office, and Howell James, Prime Minister's political secretary. They're clustered, clearly ready for the Prime Minister to emerge himself from that door with its brass plate saying First Lord of the Treasury. And we're expecting him out any second now. The atmosphere has calmed down here somewhat in Downing Street since I last spoke to you. On that occasion, a press photographer fell off his stepladder rather close to me, and there was a great deal of commotion. But everybody's got themselves in good order now, ready for the Prime Minister to emerge.
Presumably everything here is planned. I mean, this timing at just after 12:30 hasn't come about by chance.
Well, certainly not. These elections are fought out largely in the media these days. There are fewer public meetings, there's less door-to-door canvassing. The message, as they can get it out on the airwaves, is crucial to the politicians, and this has obviously been timed ready for the lunchtime television bulletins, and that will have been very much in their minds.
And how quickly will the campaigning as such get underway after this announcement?
Well, the Prime Minister will go shooting off this afternoon, we're told, to a marginal constituency somewhere north of London to get among the people, to get out in the marketplace, as he's promising to do in this campaign. It'll be very much a get Mr. Major to the people campaign as far as the Tories are concerned. Here he comes now.
Good morning. I'd like to formally confirm that I've seen Her Majesty the Queen this morning and sought her permission for a dissolution of Parliament and a general election on the 1st of May. I'm delighted to tell you that Her Majesty has consented to that. I would expect a prorogation of Parliament within a few days, formal dissolution in early April. Parliament will reassemble on the 7th of May for the election of Speaker and swearing in of members, and the Queen's speech will begin on the 14th of May. Over the last 18 years, we've seen a very dramatic change in the lifestyle of people in this country. There's been a revolution in choice, in opportunity, and in living standards. At the general election, there's a choice between the party that has brought that revolution about and the two parties that have opposed almost every single aspect of those changes. It would be ironic indeed if those parties that have opposed all the things that have brought us to our present standard of living would have pretended themselves that they were capable of carrying them forward. At the election, there will be a quite distinct choice of policies between the major parties. We have set out some very clear, long-term policies to deal with almost every aspect of concern to people in this country: health, welfare, education, law and order, as well as sustaining the most secure economic conditions we've known in this country for a very long time. These are the matters that will be of debate, I hope detailed and careful debate and discussion throughout the general election in every part of the country. Also, of course, is the significant question of constitutional change. I am not opposed to appropriate changes in the Constitution. Indeed, in the past 5 years, we've made a number of constitutional changes, perhaps more in many respects than most predecessor parliaments. But I believe that some of the constitutional changes proposed by our political opponents are dangerous and need to be exposed for the perils that would lie ahead were we to go down that route. May the 1st is, of course, the anniversary of the coming into force of the Act of Union. I have, like I guess most of you, waited a long time for this general election. I'm delighted we've now got it. I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to getting out of Whitehall and Westminster and campaigning in every part of the country and taking the message of what we've achieved and of our hopes and ambitions for this country out to people in every part of the United Kingdom. Elections, some people say, are tough and grueling businesses. Well, up to a point that's true, but I think they're also a lot of fun. And I'm looking forward to going up and down the country, taking the message that I believe is right for this country to everyone. Now, I can take just one or two questions, and then I have some guests for luncheon. Chris Moncrief.
Prime Minister, how confident are you of winning this election?
I think we'll win this election. I remember being asked that on the doorsteps of Downing Street in 1992, and I'm still here in 1997, and I expect to be here after this election.
Prime Minister.
Mr. Brunson. Well, I hope they might also set out what their plans are. I think it'd be very agreeable if we knew a little beyond the sound bites that we're occasionally treated to. I think a long campaign is right, but I think there's an inevitability about it in any event, because we now have to spend a few days completing work in Parliament, and then, of course, we have Easter coming up immediately ahead. So although I'm sure the campaign will start almost immediately, I doubt it will be in full swing in all its aspects until the beginning of April.
Prime Minister, Mr. Bolton.
Would you meet Mr. Blair and Mr. Ashdown in a three-way debate if it's decided that that's the only thing which is legally possible?
I very much wish to meet Mr. Blair in a debate. The Labour Party have been talking about this for a long time. I think it's a good idea. I welcome it, providing it's a responsible, long debate dealing with detail. I think it will enhance the democratic process, not damage it. After the election, either Mr. Blair or I will be Prime Minister. I have some sympathy for Mr. Ashdown's position. I'm sure the broadcasters might find some way to involve him, but I think the principal debate will be between the leader of the Labour Party and myself, but I don't exclude some involvement. Yes, last question, John Sargent.
Can I ask you whether at the moment you accept that you are well behind Labour?
Well, I see what the opinion polls say. I also see what so many of my colleagues say when they come back from standing on the doorstep and talking to people. And I believe this election is winnable. Not only do I think it's winnable, I think I'm going to win this election, and so are the Conservative Party. We have an 18-year record that I am proud of. Of course, in 18 years, there are bruises and difficulties. That is inevitable. But I believe that nobody who looks back over the span of that 18 years could have a shred of doubt about the improvements that people have seen in this country. And the fact that they have been achieved against the opposition in almost every respect of the other two major parties in the United Kingdom might lead people to suppose these beneficial changes would not have taken place had they been in government, and they would not be continued were they to come in government. I believe that to be the case.
Prime Minister,
now, last one, Robin Oakley.
Prime Minister, haven't the people accepted that it is time for a change? And isn't it in the interests of democracy, even, that there should be a change after 18 years of one party in government?
We have changed this country. We've changed it immeasurably for the better. We haven't finished those changes. We've extended opportunities and choice to many people who didn't have them before. But there are many people who still in that context are have-nots that I'd like to turn into haves. And that is why we've set out such long-term plans on health, education, welfare, and other matters. So if people are looking for change, we are the change, and we'll carry forward what we've been doing for the last 18 years. Thank you all very much.
So the Prime Minister announcing May the 1st has so long been anticipated as he strides back into number 10, speaking throughout there without notes, interestingly deliberately making reference to the European Union. And of course, making reference to the fact that in 1992, the Conservatives were way behind in the polls, though not as far as they are now. John Prescott, what are your emotions rather than your political reactions as you watch that?
Well, like the rest of the country, they'll say, thank goodness the major government's gone. You know, it had 20-odd ministers that have resigned from it during its period. It's the most bitterly divided government and party we've seen. So I'm glad that the Prime Minister has now decided the election date is that. We're ready. I'm leaving now for Falmouth, Exeter, Plymouth, Bristol, all in one day. The election started, and let's get on with it. You have to earn the trust of the people, and that's what we intend to do.
Do you think the people are going to put up with a 6.5-week campaign without showing signs of boredom, political distress?
Well, I'm sure they'll probably make it very clear if that's what they feel, but I think the people in this country know that this is a time of democracy, time for them to listen to the arguments and to make the decision. Our obligation is to put that case as where we can, how we can, and we'll be doing that with the most extensive general election coverage, I think, of any political party.
It's tempting to say, since we came on the air 40 minutes ago, we've heard pretty much the grounds that the election's going to be fought on. But of course, the great thing about election campaigns, particularly of this period of time, is how startlingly unpredictable they can be.
Yes, well, that's why Tony Blair's constantly reminding us, and he's right, don't be complacent. You must earn that trust. Put the case. The government say we haven't got a case. We say they're one of incompetence. We both put the arguments, and all political parties will do that. Then the electorate will make its decision. Our job is to make sure they make the right decision and elect a Labour government. But you've got to convince them of that case, and that's what we'll be doing.
John Prescott, thank you very much. Robin Oakley, what did you make of the way that the Prime Minister announced that?
Well, I thought it was significant, the areas that he picked out, saying that there was a distinct choice for the electorate on health, on education, on law and order. Those are clearly issues on which the Tories are going to concentrate this election fight. Interesting, too, that the Prime Minister talked about elections. While they are grueling, they are also fun. And it's quite true that John Major perhaps is at his best in elections. He does seem to enjoy personal contact with the people. He's better at election fighting than he is at some of the other elements that are required of a leading politician these days.
Weren't you surprised that he also referred to May the 1st as the anniversary of the Act of Union?
No, I think that was probably quite deliberate and something that he's had at the back of his mind. He feels very strongly on the constitutional issue. He is a Conservative unionist. He's been bitterly opposed to Labour and Liberal Democrat plans for a Scottish Parliament and a Welsh Assembly. He sees those as leading on, he believes, to the splitting up of the Union of the United Kingdom. And I think that's an issue that he felt played successfully for him at the last election and which he can make play for him successfully at this election too.
How quick, we've heard from John Prescott that he is getting immediately down to electioneering. What about the Prime Minister?
Well, the Prime Minister will go off this afternoon to a marginal constituency and start his battle among the people there. But what we're into now, I think, is not only a test of the qualities of the candidates in this election, but of the electoral machines. We saw an amazingly effective electoral machine from Labour in the Wirral South by-election. Now we'll see the parties tested out on their electoral organisational abilities nationally, and that is going to be crucial, I think, in this election.
Dissolution, he said, of Parliament is going to take place on April the 8th, which is actually later than had been forecast, later than you forecast yourself. Why do you think that is?
I'm not quite sure why that is, but we're still not expecting there to be any parliamentary business after Easter. The actual date of dissolution does not matter all that much in the sense that the parliamentary business will be wrapped up before the Easter recess. I don't think we're expecting there to be any parliamentary business after Easter.
Well, I hope Rosanna Cunningham can hear us now in Glasgow from the SNP, the Scottish National Party. Rosanna, what did you make of his reference to the Act of Union? There you are, sitting in Scotland, where overwhelmingly the polls say they want a different form of government. They want some sort of devolution, and of course you will maintain many want outright separation from England. Yet the Prime Minister is supremely confident that his unionism will win the day.
Well, I think what he's doing is playing to an English audience, and that's something which has been quite clear now for some time. He must know that on this particular argument he can't win in Scotland. I think that's pretty settled, and I'm absolutely sure that it's not Scotland he's got his eye on when he's debating this matter.
He referred to 1992 and how the pundits had got it wrong then, and I think he believes that in 1992 it was his unionism that got him one or two Scottish seats that others had predicted he would lose.
Well, yes, I mean, you have to remember we have a four-party system in Scotland, so the actual election within different constituencies can be slightly unpredictable. But don't forget that in 1992, the huge supposed victory that he had in Scotland had resulted in only about 1% increase in the vote, and in reality, they really were roundly defeated in Scotland, and they will be again.
What's going to happen about this television debate? There was talk there about how to accommodate Paddy Ashdown, and obviously you're going to kick and scream like crazy if the SNP is not represented.
Well, absolutely. Look, you know, I mean, there is a reality of politics in Scotland. We have a four-party system here, and the real debate in Scotland is between the SNP and the Labour Party. Now, you know, regardless of what John Major thinks he might want to do south of the border, the reality is that he cannot ignore the situation in Scotland. And in Scotland, if it's going to be beamed into Scotland, then he will have to deal with the SNP as well as presumably the Liberal Democrats in the UK as a whole. I think it's an absolute nonsense for the Prime Minister or anybody else to try and turn this into an election in which there are, according to them, only two real parties fighting. That is not the case. It's certainly not the case in Scotland, and it's not the case in the UK as a whole. And the sooner John Major and everybody else comes to terms with that reality, the better for everybody.
Of course, one of the realities of Scotland is that however strongly people do care about devolution or independence, they also care about all the other factors that affect people right across the United Kingdom. And independence or devolution tends to be fairly low on the priorities, even of those who feel strongly about this.
Well, it's still rates in the top five.
Well, I'm afraid we've lost the line, but Claire Short is here. I'm sorry about that, Rosanna. But Claire Short, what are you? I asked John Prescott what he felt emotionally rather than as a straight political response to the announcement. What about you? You've fought enough elections. How excited are you about this one?
I think the whole country's been waiting so long that instead of the usual excitement, it's at last let's get on with it. I think the country has been sort of bored by waiting and waiting as the government sort of waits and waits and hopes for something to come up. So I'm just ever so glad it's now being called. Want to get on with it, want to do the voting. I don't think a long campaign will be attractive to the country either. I find that people want the vote, want to get rid of this government, want to change. That's very much the mood.
Rosanna Cunningham, you're back. It was nothing personal, believe me. Sorry, you were in the middle of saying something, I think, were you?
Yes, but we were talking about the priorities for Scotland.
That's right. You were saying it's still among the top five,
devolution
or independence.
It is still among the top five, yes, indeed it is. And people are not daft in Scotland. They can relate all the other issues to the constitutional issue as well. I mean, that's a debate that we've been having in Scotland for such a long time. We are accustomed to being able to deal with all of the broad range of policies, but in the context, in the framework of arguing for constitutional change. And obviously, from our point of view, the best way for us to be able to move forward in Scotland is to have a parliament free from all Westminster interference, which is what we will be arguing in this election campaign.
Rosanna Cunningham, thank you very much indeed. Claire Short, you're saying this is a bit of an anticlimax. Is it going to be an anticlimax as far as the public is concerned? Is everybody going to be fed up to the teeth of politicians by the time May the 1st comes around?
I think that's the danger, and that would be very sad, because there are some very, very important issues we need to discuss about the future of the country. I mean, the pretense that the economy is perfect, we're carrying far too high a level of unemployment, that's damaging lots of people's lives. It means we're spending a lot of money on social security that we could spend much more sensibly on the health service and education and so on. So I think the fact that the country's bored, waiting, is a bad way to start the election, but I hope we'll get on with the real discussion that the country does want to talk about, a better future.
You've got to be very careful as a party not to fall into any potholes between now and May the 1st. You yourself, of course, have been roundly criticised by colleagues for things which you didn't think were a problem at all, and others suddenly made headlines out of. These are dangerous times, aren't they, for everybody?
Exciting times, dangerous times, the two go together. I mean, election campaigns are exciting and dangerous. I mean, it's the big decision that everyone's been waiting for, but I think everyone's delighted to get on with it.
Do you find elections fun, as the Prime Minister does?
Enormously. I think the best thing about politics is the real people who live in the country, and when you spend a lot of time amongst them, you get much more intelligent political debate than we often have in the House of Commons.
How much is this going to be about personalities? How much is it going to be about policy? And we all say, look, there are a lot of policies to get across, and every member of the public says, yes, of course, I want to know about the issues. Actually, most people want to see if there's going to be a gaffe. Most people just want to look into the whites of the eyes of the potential leaders, don't they?
I think most people aren't as obsessed with the minutiae as people like you are paid to be. I think people care about the future of the country. They want their vote. They're quite wise about the big decisions, but they're not obsessed with the detail in the way in which the sort of ever-growing media pack is. But that's just the world we live in. But I think the people of Britain are very sensible. They know what the main issues are. They know that the country is not in this wonderful economic shape. I was talking to a woman this morning who said, we must get unemployment down, Claire. There are far too many young men with nothing to do. These are the real issues for the real people.
Well, let's just talk to some of the real campaigners here who've been spending so long gearing up for this.
I'd like to say a word about the controversy over the debates. If the Prime Minister wants to fight this election partly in the courts, then he's going the best way about it, because I can tell you that the Liberal Democrats have taken advice some time ago on this issue. We are entitled to take part in a live debate involving all three party leaders, and if necessary...
What about Rosanna Cunningham?
In Scotland and Wales, separate arrangements have already been made. I'm the leader of the Liberal Democrats in Wales. We've already agreed some time ago to to a four-party leaders debate in Wales, and in Scotland the same should take place. But we have a UK Parliament, and it is the three UK parties which must take place. And, you know, I warn the Prime Minister here and now that there is no way they will get away with his deliberate attempt to sideline the Liberal Democrats, who he knows are challenging the Conservative Party in a great swathe of seats, particularly in the
South. It's not just the Liberal Democrats he's trying to exclude. I mean, he wants certainly to elbow out Paddy Ashdown. He also wants to exclude an audience, I mean, members of the public being able to put questions directly.
Will you accede
to that? No, I don't want that at all. I want the public involved. I want members of the public there with the opportunity to put their questions directly to the politicians. He has also insisted behind the scenes on there being one anchor person, David Dimbleby is his chosen personality, rather than having a collection of people with different approaches.
David Wiggles here from Plaid Cymru. David, how would you feel about this if you did get squeezed out? Are you prepared to go to law?
I'd be extremely unhappy if we were squeezed out, and we are taking legal advice on the position. I think there are two or three points. The most important point that is emerging rapidly now is that the Prime Minister appears to be able to call all the shots, to lay down his terms to the broadcasters, exactly what may be undertaken. I think there's an argument in Wales and Scotland that all the aspects should be presented to the electorate, and there's an angle in England as well. If the Prime Minister is running on devolution and assemblies for Wales, Parliament for Scotland, as the main issues, the people of England have a right to know exactly what the counter-arguments are.
Right, well, we don't know what's going to happen about the television debate. We do now know the election will, of course, be on May the 1st. That's all from this special edition of Westminster. We'll be back at 3:05 on BBC Two tomorrow. Until then, good afternoon.
'Apologies if you were expecting the alphabet game and going for a song, both made way for special coverage on BBC One of John Major's announcement of the date for the general election.
G'day. We're back with a new series of Animal Hospital from a brand new location, Hampden Veterinary Hospital in Aylesbury. It's a real country practice with patients ranging from pocket-sized pets like this little character here to farm animals and horses. We'll be keeping an eye on Holly, a puppy who really needs to learn some manners, meeting Madonna. That's a duck. And a stray cat whose life hangs in the balance. Join me for Animal Hospital, Thursday, 8 o'clock, BBC One.
Now on BBC One, a look at how the Met Office forecasts the weather.
Probably wondered where weather forecasts start. They all start with observations of the weather made routinely in every country of the world and from the oceans. We do this in this country. We have a number of sites around the country that make surface observations and also fly weather balloons. This is fairly long-standing equipment which has improved with time. In fact, the equipment itself, the electronic package, has become smaller and therefore we're able to use a smaller balloon to carry it aloft. Typically, the balloon will reach a height of about 15 miles, 25 kilometres. When it starts off, it's probably around about 2 metres, 2.5 metres in diameter. By the time it gets to the altitude at which it bursts, it'll be, 4 or 5 times that or more. It measures temperature, pressure, humidity, wind speed and direction, and radios that information back to Earth, and that is then collected via telecommunications into our computer here in Bracknell and goes into the computer model.
Well, Britain, being an island country, all our weather comes from the ocean, so it's very important that we have those observations from the ocean area surrounding us. We have automatic weather stations on the light vessels, which you hear in the shipping broadcast. We have automatic weather stations on platforms in the North Sea, on remote islands off the shores of Scotland, and on a network of moored buoys. These buoys measure pressure, temperature, humidity, wind speed, wind direction, sea temperature and wave height and period. The data are telemetered back to a satellite over the equator, from whence they get transmitted down to Darmstadt and back to our telecommunication centre in Bracknell. These data are then fed into the models from which all the forecasts emanate. In addition to the moored buoys, we also operate networks of drifting buoys. These are much smaller packages which are deployed from a variety of sources. We have buoys which are deployed over the polar ice caps, called, not surprisingly, ice buoys. Typically these are deployed by aircraft on a parachute, and they will sit on the ice telemetering back values of pressure and air temperature. When the ice breaks up, these will then become free drifting buoys measuring the same parameters over the ocean. Since they move according to the ocean currents and the winds, it's very important, in fact essential, that we know exactly where they are. This is achieved using satellite location, as observations are no use unless we know where they come from.
In 50 years' time, will you laugh at computers ever being this big? In 50 years' time, will junk shops be full of compact discs? In 50 years' time, will mobile phones just seem old hat? What seemed amazing yesterday is everyday today and could be tomorrow's museum pieces. Catch a glimpse of your future. Join the Tomorrow's World live event Wednesday at 7:30 on BBC One.
The 1 o'clock news now on BBC One with Edward Sturton.
I'd like to formally confirm that I've seen Her Majesty the Queen this morning and sought her permission for a dissolution of Parliament and a general election on the 1st of May. I'm delighted to tell you that Her Majesty has consented to that.
Good afternoon. The phony war is now over. The election campaign proper will begin after Easter. Tony Blair welcomed the news. The Labour leader said, at long last, we are underway.
How are you going to make
Also today, a rescue operation has saved 800 Albanian refugees from a sinking ship off the Italian coast. And a former transport minister says the Newbury bypass was built in the wrong place. The Prime Minister has fired the starting pistol, although he doesn't expect battle to be fully joined until early April. The countdown to the election looks like this. Parliament breaks up for the Easter recess around March the 26th. The parties launch their election manifestos in the first week in April. Parliament has to be dissolved by April the 8th, and both the general and local elections will be held on May the 1st. Our political correspondent Hugh Edwards is in Downing Street.
Ed, a very good afternoon to you. Here we are at the start of a six-week-long campaign. It promises to be the most personalised, the most presidential campaign we've ever seen in this country. Campaigns, of course, from the party point of view, are already in place. They'll get underway in earnest in after Easter, I'd have thought, and they might well include a head-to-head debate between the leaders themselves. Here in Downing Street, as expected, it's been a very busy morning, and this is how things went.
The scene was set early this morning, all eyes on the country's most famous front door, ahead of a long campaign that could bring a change of tenants, not just in Downing Street, but in every ministerial office in Westminster.
Well, let's hope so.
Up in North London, Tony Blair left home knowing that the next 6 weeks will present his reformed Labour Party with its ultimate test.
I think the choice for the country will be very, very clear. It's between a Conservative Party that's just a disorganised shambles, that is poorly led and incompetent in government, and a Labour Party that has changed, that has revitalised, and that is addressing the future.
And down in Whitehall, the Deputy Prime Minister put up a typically bullish performance.
Are you feeling confident?
Of course. Conservatives got to win because we deserve to win. We have the best economy in Europe because the Conservative policies made that possible.
and he would soon be in Downing Street with other cabinet colleagues. They'd been summoned by Mr. Major to share the worst-kept secret of recent times, the date of the general election. At the back of the building, rather ominously, a removal van, nothing to do with the election arrangements, said Number 10. And as the street was prepared for the day's events, cabinet ministers emerged after their short meeting.
You going to win, Dr. Mawinney?
And Mr. Major followed a short while later, off to see the Queen to ask her to agree the necessary constitutional arrangements. Barely half an hour after that, he was back in Downing Street. He went inside to put the finishing touches to his statement, and an hour after he'd seen Her Majesty, Mr. Major fired the starting gun for the election campaign of 1997.
Good morning. I'd like to formally confirm that I've seen Her Majesty the Queen this morning and sought her permission for a dissolution of Parliament and a general election on the 1st of May. I'm delighted to tell you that Her Majesty has consented to that. Over the last 18 years, we've seen a very dramatic change in the lifestyle of people in this country. There's been a revolution in choice, in opportunity, and in living standards. At the general election, there's a choice between the party that has brought that revolution about and the two parties that have opposed almost every single aspect of those changes. It would be ironic indeed if those parties that have opposed all the things that have brought us to our present standard of living were to pretend themselves that they were capable of carrying them forward. At the election, there will be a quite distinct choice of policies between the major parties. We have set out some very clear, long-term policies to deal with almost every aspect of concern to people in this country: health, welfare, education, law and order, as well as sustaining the most secure economic conditions we've known in this country for a very long time. These are the matters that will be of debate, I hope detailed and careful debate and discussion throughout the general election in every part of the country. Also, of course, is the significant question of constitutional change. I am not opposed to appropriate changes in the Constitution. Indeed, in the past 5 years, we've made a number of constitutional changes, perhaps more in many respects than most predecessor parliaments. But I believe that some of the constitutional changes proposed by our political opponents are dangerous and need to be exposed for the perils that would lie ahead were we to go down that route. May the 1st is, of course, the anniversary of the coming into force of the Act of Union. I have, like I guess most of you, waited a long time for this general election. I'm delighted we've now got it. I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to getting out of Whitehall and Westminster and campaigning in every part of the country and taking the message of what we've achieved and of our hopes and ambitions for this country out to people in every part of the United Kingdom. Elections, some people say, are tough and grueling businesses. Well, up to a point that's true, but I think they're also a lot of fun. And I'm looking forward to going up and down the country, taking the message that I believe is right for this country to everyone.
Prime Minister, haven't the people accepted that it is time for a change? And isn't it in the interests of democracy, even, that there should be a change after 18 years of one party in government?
We have changed this country. We've changed it immeasurably for the better. We haven't finished those changes. We've extended opportunities and choice to many people who didn't have them before. But there are many people who still in that context are have-nots that I'd like to turn into haves. And that is why we've set out such long-term plans on health, education, welfare and other matters. So if people are looking for change, we are the change, and we'll carry forward what we've been doing for the last 18 years. Thank you all very much.
That was John Major speaking here in Downing Street just a short while ago, and the campaigning gets underway immediately. This afternoon, a little later today, Mr. Major's soapbox, the famous soapbox, will make an appearance, we think, in Luton, and Mr. Blair, the Labour leader, will be travelling, we think, to Gloucester to talk to voters in that marginal constituency. 6 weeks of it to come, Edward, and we will, I've no doubt, enjoy every second of it.
Hugh, thanks very much indeed. And I'm now joined by the Labour leader, Tony Blair, who's at a school in South East London. Mr. Blair, you've been waiting for this for a long time, but you've never done it before. Are you nervous at all?
No, I'm actually rather excited by it, and excited by the prospect. At long last, as you say, we've had virtually, I think, a year of electioneering, and not much government, so we're delighted to get the whole thing underway. Sooner the better.
You've got this whopping lead in the opinion polls. The conventional wisdom says that that's probably a false impression. Do you have a sense yourself of where your real level of support lies?
What is important is that people who, some of whom have been lifelong conservatives, are coming over to the Labour Party, and they're coming over because they see a Conservative Party that is discredited, rather out of date, that has been weakly led and rather incompetent in government, and a Labour Party that is genuinely New Labour, where, for example, this morning over 50% of businesses are saying that they want a Labour government. So I think it is the contrast between the two political parties that has given us support, but you're absolutely right. It's only on election day that you know the proper level of that support.
But you must have some sense of that. You must be doing your own polling. Can you give me an idea of what the figures look like to you?
I won't start going into figures, but I mean, there is certainly a very strong desire in the country, not just for change for its own sake, but a belief that after 18 years of Conservative government, particularly after the broken promises on tax and crime and the health service over these past few years, that it is right to make a change, provided that people know it is a new and revitalised Labour Party there. Now, it is true, we're certainly finding, as we saw with the recent by-election of Wirral South, a great deal of support for us. But we take absolutely nothing for granted.
Given that you shadow the Conservatives so closely on so many policy areas, aren't you going to find it difficult to give people an impression that there really is a distinction between you and Mr. Major?
No, you see, this is, with all due respect, nonsense. Of course there are certain things that we believe. For example, we've made the pledge not to raise the basic and top rates of income tax. We've made the pledge not to repeal the basic elements, the essential elements of the 1980s trade union legislation. We want a strong and enterprising business sector to the economy. But there are clear differences between ourselves and the Conservatives.
Because of all that, you've been described as Mrs. Thatcher's greatest legacy.
No, I think what I would say is, look, there are certain things that the 1980s got right, but there are certain things that it got badly wrong. Better schools, you know, how we raise the educational standards, that is the critical question facing Britain in the future in a new technological age. How we rebuild the National Health Service, which is failing our people in many parts of the country now. How we get our young people off benefit, where it's costing billions of pounds a year, and into proper work. How we deal with the problems of crime, violent crime, having doubled in this country. So these are all things that we need to do for our country.
Looking back on the eve of the campaign, well, I suppose really the campaign having begun, looking back to the 92 campaign, what were the main mistakes made then that you will try and avoid this time?
The essential difference is that the Conservatives made a whole lot of promises. Mr. Major made the promise about not raising tax, not raising VAT, you know, the National Health Service would be safe in his hands. Those promises lie broken. That's one difference. The other difference is a Labour Party that is addressing the future, that is looking forward, that has learnt its lessons.
I was thinking about the mistakes the Labour might have made last time.
Yes, but that's exactly what I'm saying to you, though, Edward. I think that at the last election, people still didn't feel that it really was a proper and changed Labour Party. Now, we have transformed the Labour Party. You saw Alan Howarth, you know, the former Conservative Member of Parliament, came to Labour, selected by ordinary Labour Party members for one of the safest Labour seats in the country. You know, this is a changed perspective, and it is the combination of the broken promises of the Conservative, their record, if you like, and the changed nature of the Labour Party that is the clue to the difference in public mood now and in 1992.
Well, Mr. Blair, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
And joining me now from his Yeovil constituency is the Liberal Democrats leader, Paddy Ashdown. Mr. Ashdown, it's an important point that Tony Blair makes there, isn't it, about the change in the Labour Party. It means that many people who in the past might have voted for you because they didn't like the Conservatives but were frightened of Labour won't now do so.
Not much sign of that, Ed. Quite the contrary. The party has continued to strengthen over the last 2 years, and its hold in those seats where we are now the clear challengers to the Conservatives, 20 or 30 odd seats where the Liberal Democrats are the clear challengers, its hold has in fact strengthened. If you look at the opinion polls, if you look at the by-elections, if you look at the local government by-elections that take place every single week, many thousands of real votes and real ballot boxes, it shows that very clearly. I'm delighted the election has now been called, about time too. It seems to have been delay and dither right up until the last moment. Frankly, I can't think why we can't hold it in April rather than May, but the campaign has now started. We begin now to make the choices for Britain's future. And the choices, we believe, are quite clear for the British electorate. They are between promises you can't believe and clear, costed, realistic, targeted commitments about what we must do to face up to the challenges as this country enters the next century. It is between two parties who think that the most important thing for Britain in last November's budget was to give us a temporary, and I do mean temporary, penny cut in income tax, and one party, the Liberal Democrats, who believes that money should be invested for the long term in education and in health.
You're not at all concerned that you will be squeezed because people switch straight from the Tories to the Labour Party?
That's the kind of thing that you often say in London newsrooms, but take a look on the ground and you have no sign of it. But why is it, if we are squeezed, that the Liberal Democrats are actually continuing to rise in local government elections right across the country? Now, I don't pretend that local government reads across the general elections, but if you measure our position now in local government elections with that before the last election, you'll find it's by a mark better. Take a look at the by-elections that have been fought, I think eight in this parliament. We've won four of them, more than any of the other parties. Take a look at how the party's now doing. The squeeze is something I'm told
Let me put this to you then. If it looks as if it's going to be a Labour landslide, will you effectively start campaigning for a hung parliament?
No, you can't campaign for a hung parliament. A hung parliament is a statistical quirk. It's a statistical outcome. We campaign for our policies. And the important thing is that with Labour now so close to the Conservatives, that the Liberal Democrats are now the only party who offers something different. I mean, let me give you an example. I'm in Somerset. I've been campaigning in Somerset this morning on education. People here of whatever political persuasion are furious that, once again, they're losing their teacher in their local school. No point in going to ask Labour what they're going to do about that. Labour's now adopted the Conservatives' budget. They're actually going to spend less on the NHS, although our hospital's in crisis, than the Conservatives are. There's only one party that is now putting forward the propositions most people in this country want to hear about the long-term investment in education and tackling the crisis in health, and that's the Liberal Democrats. Only one party is prepared to be honest about taxation. And I think people welcome that.
Thank you very much indeed. On the steps of Downing Street, Mr. Major said the Constitution would be one of the main issues of the election campaign. He said he was not opposed to change, but that Labour's proposals would be dangerous. That's prompted a strong reaction from the nationalist parties in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland.
All the political parties have been planning on the assumption it would be May the 1st for weeks, so today's announcement didn't exactly make the earth move at Westminster. The Liberal Democrats, while fighting every constituency, will be targeting their campaign more than ever on winnable seats. Outside England, for those parties standing only within their own territorial boundaries, today's task was to remind everyone that this is more than a two or three horse race.
For the SNP, our hopes are very high. I mean, we are the second party in Scotland, trying hard to be the first party in Scotland. So we go into this campaign with high hopes and brave hearts.
Indeed, the nationalist parties say John Major himself has made their views of truly national significance.
Mr. Major has said that this is going to be a debate largely about the constitutional issues, in which case the proposals we have need to be put to the electorate in England as well, so they can evaluate fully the claims being made by the Prime Minister.
Until now, the Ulster Unionists have had a powerful role, courted by the Conservatives because of their ability to shore up the government's majority. They know that the closer the result, the more influence they'll have after the election.
I would take the view that any government with a very large majority tends to be unreceptive to the views of other people, and I think Parliament only works properly whenever governments have to sit down and think about their legislation and whether it has a wide acceptance.
The formal announcement of the date has pros and cons for the smaller parties. A share of the national spotlight is guaranteed for them by the election rules. But as attention focuses on the central question, who will be Prime Minister on May the 2nd, they know they can play at best a supporting role. Lance Price, BBC News, Westminster.
Well, the election is likely to be decided in the nation's marginal seats. If Labour take 57, they'll have a majority. Carolyn Quinn reports on the key electoral battlegrounds.
For Labour to win the election, it'll be crucial to swing voters like these in Leeds North East. Conservative held, for a long time, Liberal Democrats were the main challengers here. But now the seat is 57th on Labour's target list, and as such is the winning post for them. If they pass it, they'll have achieved a majority in government. Leeds North East is similar to most marginals in this campaign, made up of some poorer areas but mostly prosperous suburbs, the white, car-owning middle class. The Schofield family admit their lifestyle is comfortable, but say despite the economic upturn, their money still doesn't seem to go as far as it used to. Traditional Tory voters, they say this time they're wavering. They're exactly the type of key voters who'll decide the election outcome.
I've always voted Conservative in the past. This year, this election, particularly because of the Conservative policies on the NHS, privatisation, taxation, law and order, I shall be giving some serious thought to the Labour Party and possibly the Liberals.
I feel like I should continue, but that's just wrong, really. We're changing, aren't we?
Well, we're undecided.
Undecided.
The Schofields MP is defending a Conservative majority of just over 4,000. For Labour to snatch this prize, they'd need a swing of 4.3%. Since 1945, the best they've achieved is a 3% swing. That was in 1964 under Harold Wilson. Across the nation, there'll be a number of key battlegrounds. For the Conservatives, the aim is to hold the seats they already have, and they'd like to regain by-election losses like Newbury and Christchurch. For Labour, their target seats in the Midlands and South East will be particularly important. And for the Liberal Democrats, it's the South and South West and a measles scattering of seats in the North.
Labour, through the troubles of losing in 1979 and then being humiliated in the defeat in 1983, were driven out of the suburban areas and especially the prosperous Midlands and South of England. And that leaves a map that looks just a sea of blue outside the big cities. They are desperately keen to break up that sea of blue with, at the very least, pockets of red in the main urban centres in the south.
One seat to watch on election night in particular will be Gravesham in Kent, which includes Gravesend Town. Regarded as a weather vane seat, it usually selects an MP from the party that goes on to form the government. Labour's strong in the built-up areas, but step outside to the rural belt, like Cobham here, and it's traditionally conservative. The feel-good factor may appear to be in evidence, but the Tories don't always get the credit.
People almost, for no real conviction, will just vote Labour just because it's time for a change.
I think the Tories will use some underhand methods on the last few weeks and they'll manage it. That's my biggest fear.
People should start counting their blessings and realise that how well off they really are in this country.
If Labour do manage to win in marginal constituencies like Gravesham, it'll be largely due to swinging the votes of the prosperous, traditional Tory areas like Cobham here, with evidence that about a third of voters leave it till the last weeks of the campaign before deciding. It's clear the battle in areas like this will be fierce. Carolyn Quinn, BBC News, in Cobham, in Kent.